ufologists, I want to dive into more of how are we going to get away from pain? How can we help to have that pain-free lifestyle? So pain itself. Are oftentimes in two different ways. So we have trauma-induced. Yeah. And then we have non-trauma. Good so far, right?
It may not be dark enough. You might want to.
Is there...
Let's see what we have over there. Maybe just a different... Sorry.
Oh.
Try
this. Maybe? No?
Yeah.
Better.
And if my chicken scratch and no one can read, just let me know. I'll warn, I'm going to be drawing and writing, and I mean, I'm no artistic writer, and I'm not a Picasso, so if there's anything that people can't see, just let me know. So first off with trauma. This one most people know about. So you're in a car accident, you had a sports injury, you had a slip and fall, something like that. There was a specific mode of injury, right? And so that may lead into a fracture, a bruise, a pulled muscle, anything like that. And then that will lead to inflammation, which will result in pain. Good? Nothing crazy so far? Okay. So now, non-trauma. This oftentimes is more metabolic in nature, more chemical, so a lot more in how your body's hormone system is working. So, metabolic. So that could be fibromyalgia. Epstein-Barr virus, fever, autoimmune disease, and the list continues on. Any of those different things, which will result in inflammation and pain. Nothing crazy so far, right?
What was the third one after Epstein-Barr?
Fever. Yeah, sorry, chicken scratch. So that's fibromyalgia, Epstein-Barr virus, fever, autoimmune disease. And that's not an exhaustive list. That is a lot of chronic, different diseases, things like that. Even chronic pain goes here. Because oftentimes, even chronic pain may start off as a trauma. Maybe you were in a car accident. Maybe you had an injury. But over time, it's not gotten better. Oftentimes, that will then transfer over into this metabolic side because you've had so much of this chronic inflammation over time that has not been resolved. That it goes into more of this feeding cycle that does not stop. And so, let's take a step back again and look more at this trauma side of things. So again, warning, not Picasso. So here it comes. So here's the brain, and then we have our spinal cord coming down, and we have all our nerves coming out here. Okay, so let's say that we go and we go running and we slip, fall, we break our foot. So here is our little foot down here. So he has a fracture. What that's going to do, he's going to come up into the brain, and a signal's going to come to the brain, hey, there was an injury. We have a problem. So the brain now is going to come back down and say, okay, we're going to bring healing mediators. I'm going to bring inflammation. Inflammation in short periods is great. It starts to break down all those bad things, and it starts to bring in healing mediators, mediators. So inflammation can be good. It's when it goes for too long that becomes a problem. But, so we have this injury. And so what happens? You break your leg. You start to see that it's red, it's swollen, it hurts to walk, all these different things. So what are you going to do? You're going to start to rest. You're going to ice it, compress it, elevate it, all these things immediately. Then you're going to go to a doctor. They're going to probably put a cast on it, which will stay for 4 to 8 weeks, depending on what's the extremity that you broke. And then they're going to give you pain relievers, all these things. And then you'll take it off, and your bone will start that healing process. So that's trauma. How do you cast fibromyalgia? How do you cast autoimmune disease? It doesn't work like that. So you have to have a different mechanism to treat some of those than what you necessarily would for a trauma injury. And that's kind of what we're going to focus more on, is really some of those chronic pains and what are the different lifestyle things that we can do at home to start to help this process of decreasing inflammation. Okay? Any questions on my lovely little drawing and things like that so far? Uh-oh, there they go. have us along for the long haul. That's okay. And as I'm going through this, I have some certain things I'm planning on saying, but if you guys have questions, go for it. Because at the end, I'm going to have a long period where we have question and answer, but if you have burning questions in the middle of it, go for it. Stuff does not like to come off, that's okay. Perfect. So, what is the best way that we can decrease inflammation? The number one way we can do that is through our diet. So, why is that so important? Because your ability to heal, your ability to think, your ability to move, anything you do comes from what you eat. Because what you eat goes through your digestive tract, is broken down, and then all of those vitamins, minerals, chemicals is absorbed and goes through different tissues and allows your body to function. So when your mom always jokes and is like, you are what you eat, it's kind of true. Not necessarily that you eat a watermelon, you're gonna become a watermelon, but if you're eating good quality food, you will get good quality results. If you eat things that are not good quality, your body's not gonna be able to function properly. It's the same type of thing. And so when it comes to diet, there are foods that tend to be very inflammatory for the population. Not that these foods are necessarily inherently bad, God put them on this earth to kill us, not by any means, but just that our bodies aren't necessarily able to digest them appropriately, especially with what we've done to them over time with genetic modification and things like that. So we're going to talk about four of them today. First one is going to be gluten. Next one is casein. Next one is corn. Next one is artificial sweeteners. These words may look a little strange to you, and you may not know what they all mean. So let's flesh them out a little bit. Gluten's pretty big right now. A lot of people hear about gluten sensitivities, gluten allergies, because a lot of people are actually gluten intolerant, celiac intolerant. So when you have celiac, it means you have an autoimmune disease to gluten. You eat gluten, your body's immune system goes after it. Now, there's also non-celiac or non-autoimmune disease gluten sensitivity, which is very much prevalent in the population. And so that's kind of what we're going to at today, but there are both sides of it. So gluten is wheat, barley, and rye. Now, when I say is, I should say gluten is a protein that is in those. It is not those things specifically, it is a protein. So casein, other magic word, is the protein in milk, cheese, cream of mushroom soups, ranch dressings, anything like that. Dairy products. And corn, that's not just necessarily corn on the cob, it's also high fructose corn syrup, corn starch, all of those things. And high fructose corn syrup hides in so many different things. If you go to Starbucks, they're probably going to have high fructose corn syrup in there, or any different places you go because they're cheap. It's a cheap sweetener and preservative, so it's two for the price of one. And so you can use a little bit and get a lot of sweetener. So most things are sweetened, high fructose corn syrup.
Can you say that word really slowly? High
fructose corn syrup.
Oh, okay,
syrup.
Okay. And that's not what I was
understanding.
Number two is casein. It's casein, C-A-S-E-I-N, and dairy products. And good point. I'm from the north, I talk really fast. So if I need to slow down, and if you don't catch something, do not hesitate to ask me again. And I mean that. Especially since it's being recorded for everyone else. If you can't understand it, they probably can't either. So if there's something I say too fast, you can't understand me, please stop me, rewind me, and I will go much slower. Because I know, especially when I get excited, floodgates are off. So, yes, major disclaimer there. Please slow me down if I need to. Okay, so did we all get corn? Understand high fructose corn syrup. Okay. So artificial sweeteners, that could be aspartame and Splenda, all of those different ones. And what they do is that since you use less of them and get more sweetness, that's why they started using them, because they're so much cheaper. Well, A, people don't use less of them because they use the same amount, and B, what's the big problem with them is that they affect your neurotransmitters. They affect things in your brain. They affect your ability diet, the big things with these is that they inflame your gut. So then now you're not able to get those nutrients we talked about at the beginning. So if your gut is so inflamed that you can't, you eat an apple, you eat all these good fruits and vegetables and things like that, you can't get the nutrients from it, that's a problem. Then you're not going to be able to function. Your body's not going to be able to decrease inflammation. You're not going to be able to have increased quality of life and more function. It's going to affect your entire body because what goes in your gut goes to your entire body. So it's a big overarching umbrella. And so when it comes to genetically modifying things, that's where some of these things have gotten especially bad in recent times because, especially corn and some of these other things, corn and wheat, because they're subsidized, we want to use them all the time. But let's make them more yield. So if we genetically modify them, we can get more of them. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing. We can feed more people. That's great. The problem with that comes is if you start making something resistant to pesticides, what are you doing? You're changing the structure of it so it's resistant to these things that can break down these foods and chemicals and things. So if you're now made these foods resistant to pesticides, what about your gut? What's in your gut that's breaking down those foods? Enzymes. And so if you made this thing super strong and resistant, now your gut can't break that down either. So that's just another way to look at it. Is genetic modification a bad thing? It's helping a lot of people, but it's also hurting a lot of us because it's increasing inflammation.
Yeah, but what if we just take a probiotic?
Different probiotics can help. And it just depends because there's good probiotics out there. For instance, ones that are soil-based organisms and have a lot of like multi-billion amount of them, which will help. But the problem is if you don't get rid of the bad ones, then those good guys can't get on the wall either. Because if how it kind of works is that you can kind of look at it as a war. There's good guys on the wall and there's bad guys on the wall. And if all the bad guys are there, they're eating because it's a good relationship. All your gut microbes in there are helping you. They're a good thing there. So now if your good ones are gone and the bad ones are all on the wall, they're not going to give up their spot for the good ones when the probiotics come. They're not going to want to do that because they're like, I have a feast. Why would I give up my feast for these other guys coming in? I'm not going to do that. And so probiotics will help, but there's other mediums you have to go through as well. And you still have to heal this gut lining because otherwise that process of that inflammation is going to keep going. And so probiotics are great, and they're a great, great, great help, but there's still other things that have to happen. As long as the gut renaissance be healed to allow that process to work. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, because I take one every day.
Yeah, and that's great. I recommend that for a lot of patients because probiotics, that's the best, especially if you take a lot of antibiotics, you need a good probiotic to put those good guys back because that's how you get rid of the bad ones. They're gone, but now if you don't put good guys in, more bad ones will take that place. Everyone good? Perfect. So that would be a diet. In that realm. So then the next thing would be what we call target-specific nutrition, which would be more of supplements. And now I'm going to talk about four today. There are a huge amount of amazing anti-inflammatory supplements out there. Vast, vast amount. But I'm going to talk about four today. So one, two, three, four. One is going to be curcumin. Another is going to be fish oil. Another is going to be resveratrol. And another is going to be berberine. Okay. So, curcumin. So you may have heard of curcumin before because it is a component of turmeric. So if you've heard of turmeric, turmeric is an Indian spice. And it's also been used for therapeutic and medicinal properties as well because of this curcumin, which is the active ingredient in it. Okay? And so curcumin, how it works in the body is very similar to your NSAIDs. You take ibuprofen and you take, good morning, come on in, take ibuprofen, you take Advil, Aleve, all of those, they block an inflammatory pathway in the body. This does a very similar thing, except for it doesn't have the bad side effects of affecting your gut, liver and your stomach and all these other different things. And so what this guy does, and it's, so you can take turmeric supplements or you can take curcumin supplements, and both are great. But the thing about curcumin in turmeric Walgreens or Walmart and get the cheapest one. You're going to want to research and look at those different supplements to see, are they actually what they say they are? Because they've had studies that have pulled Walmart supplements off the shelf and have tested them, and they came back with that they're 90% dirt. That's not actually what they say in them. And so I'm not saying that you have to get the most expensive one, but you want to look at them and see if you trust the company that's actually putting them out there. Because some of them are good and some of them are not so good. So when you're looking at, and so especially with curcumin, because it's, you have to get a very good quality one to have it be available to your body for it to use.
Well, give us an example of, because goodness, I take that and I buy it from all the places you said.
Okay.
So give us a manufacturer that we should buy it from.
Okay, we're okay with that. Okay, perfect. So I would want to look at some of these a little more specifically. And those, but I found Nature Made tends to be pretty good. Gaia tends to be pretty good. Some of those. In our office, we have some other different companies that we use. Apex Energetics has really good products as well. I tend to like some of those because I know the process that they go through. And so
Nature Made's okay?
I believe. With those, Nature Made and Gaia, honestly, because I've done so much with the professional grade ones, I would need to look at some of those that are in the stores and make sure that they are, so I'm not telling you that it's good and it's not, because I haven't done my due diligence research to tell that. So from what I have kind of looked at, Gaia and Nature Made are okay. But I want to put a big disclaimer on that. I have not done the research I feel like I would want to do to determine that for sure. So, and I can do that. I can buy homework. I can go home and I can research some of those for you, and I can get back to you on those, because I want to make sure I'm telling you the truth. I don't want to tell you, go take the supplement, and then you get a bad form of it. So I just know a lot of these active ingredients, because that's what we deal with in our office. But in our office, we use other, more of the professional products, things like that, that are going to have specifically these names, because they're different formulations.
But those wouldn't be available to the general public?
Not available to the general public unless you were to come to my office or another medical practitioner's office. Yes, ma'am. Any questions on that? Okay, so then if you're going to go get curcumin from a store, probably what they would do is an RDA would be 500 milligrams, which is great. But the problem is, with a lot of these things, what are we looking for? We're looking at people that have chronic inflammatory conditions, things like that, where their body has been fighting this for so long that those reserves are depleted. You need extra to be able to help. You need extra to be able to decrease that inflammation. So you're gonna need a therapeutic dose, something that's much higher than an RDA. And so oftentimes for curcumin, that's more like gonna be 1500 milligrams per day. But with that being said, again, if you start going up to these higher ones, you probably want to be partnering with a medical practitioner or doing your due diligent research. Because if you're taking other drugs and medications and things like that, they can interact with each other. So for instance, fish oil. If you're on a blood thinner, you take fish oil also can be a blood thinner. So if you take both at the same time, that enhances the effectiveness of it. So it's one of those things that if you start taking the therapeutic doses of any of these, that could be really, really good. But you want to make sure that you're being careful, or you're really looking at your own symptoms, or you're partnering with a good medical provider to be able to help you on that journey. So fish oils. Fish oils are omega-3 fatty acids. And so what they are, they're very anti-inflammatory. And fish oils themselves have two different components called EPA and DHA. So EPA and DHA. So EPA tends to be the more anti-inflammatory component, very cardioprotective. So it helps your heart, helps your blood vessels, and decreases inflammation. Whereas DHA tends to be more for your brain, and much for your brain health and things like that. Helps with more the Alzheimer's, the cognition, those type of things. And so both are amazing. If you're wanting to decrease inflammation, I would almost recommend getting a one-to-one supplement where they have one-to-one of EPA and DHA. Now, there are different companies and variations where they put a lot more of one versus another, because depending on what you're going for, what is your goal when it comes to taking fish oil. Other thing with fish oil is that you want to make sure it's from a good company, that it's going to electrically distill those different products, and that's coming from cold water, wild caught fish. You don't want the farm raised, because the But again, if you're going up that therapeutic dose, that TD means therapeutic dose, that's going to be anywhere from potentially 6 grams to, I've heard of, 20 grams. Big disclaimer there, if you go up to 20, you need to have someone on your side. But I found that research with someone who was treating anxiety and depression. It had amazing results with 20 grams. Big thing, you want to make sure you're partnering with someone before you take that high of a dose. Because these things are food, they're great, they're amazing for you, but the same type of thing. You take a little's great, doesn't necessarily mean that more is better. So you need to be looking at that. Resveratrol. Resveratrol is going to be, it has a lot of bioflavonoids and it helps to decrease free radicals in your body. It decreases inflammation by going after specific chemicals that create inflammation in your body. And I'm going to probably stop more or less there because I don't want to dive into too much neurology and things like that. But resveratrol has amazing, amazing anti-inflammatory components in it. And RDA for that is 250 to 500. Milligrams per day. And therapeutic dose is going to be anywhere from 2 to 5 grams. 2 to 5 grams. Again, the same type of thing. So berberine. Berberine works very similar to metformin, which metformin is for diabetes, the anti-diabetic drug. So berberine helps to balance your blood sugar. Now, when blood sugar is doing weird swings like this, it creates a massive amount of inflammation in the body. So this one helps to decrease inflammation by balancing your blood sugar. And so it can also help your gut lining and things like that. The big thing about berberine, though, is that it has a very short half-life, meaning you take it, it gets absorbed really quickly, and is no longer effective for helping. So when you take that as a supplement, you want to take it 3 times a day to allow it to be going throughout the day.
Can you take that as a diet pill, too?
You take it as a diet pill? All of these, whenever your body starts to work more efficiently, weight loss can happen. The biggest thing about trying to decrease weight and things like that, is that where you're going with that as a diet pill?
No, I mean, my doctor, I talked him into giving me a prescription for metformin to lose weight. I'm not diabetic. Mm-hmm. But then I got scared and I quit taking it.
I would definitely take supplements over medications for weight loss.
So you could take that fourth one 3 times a day like a diet pill?
Now, I would say be careful with any of those in general, but the thing is that when you're decreasing inflammation, you're allowing the body to work better, and you're balancing your hormones, weight loss should happen. When your body is functioning properly, and everything is able to work properly, and your muscles, your joints, your bones, everything is able to work properly because it has the proper nutrients, weight loss should occur. Because the body's working properly, it's not having to use the extra reserves in those other places. Does that kind of make sense?
Yeah, but I already take all those supplements and I don't look like,
And a lot of it comes down
I need
to
at least 75 pounds.
To other factors when it comes to diet as well as partnering with a medical provider to find out the root cause for you. Because the root cause for each person is different. Some people, it could be that there's more things in the environment that are affecting them. Some people it's the diet. Some people it's so the supplements and other bugs. Like some people have chronic infections that you don't know about. Just because you're not sneezing and things like that doesn't mean you don't have an underlying chronic infection. So if you've been doing all these things and you still aren't getting better, there might be something else that's going on.
Well, I had 5 cinnamon rolls this morning, so that didn't help.
That what?
Huh?
And so berberine is going to be 500 milligrams 3 times per day.
The one in the can you make in the oven.
And you can take that up to 2 grams per day.
How many?
2 grams per day is therapeutic dose.
But if you take it 3 times a day, how much is each one?
So that'd be 1,500.
Oh, 1,500?
Mm-hmm. So that would be that total. So again, no, you don't want to be taking 2-3 times per day.
No.
2 grams total.
Oh, okay.
Yep, total.
So I'm already on metformin, so is that berberine something that I should forego and just concentrate on the others?
Yeah, exactly. Or I would talk with my doctor and be like, hey, I'm going to start this, monitor my blood sugar more. That's the big thing, is just monitor your blood sugar, how you're feeling, and maybe you'll be able to go back on your metformin and more on the natural supplements. And so that's something where it's not necessarily a bad thing, but it's something you want to be telling your doctor so you don't like go into hypoglycemia. Because if you start taking both things, like you're taking metformin and this, and all these things that are lowering your blood sugar, and you with a hypoglycemia, that's not a good thing either. So it's just talking with your doctor and making sure you're having that partnership. Cool? Okay, so in addition to all of these things, again, especially, we have a couple other things on the agenda, so we're diving in, so this is a good thing, but going probably a little bit deeper than I was expecting. Not gonna have time to talk about some of the other components that are important, but I'm gonna be doing Facebook Lives and other things like that to kind of dive into them a little bit more as well. That'll be sleep. If you're not sleeping, you're not letting your body heal, because at 10 o'clock at night, human growth hormone comes out. That is what allows your body to heal. So if you're not sleeping properly, that's a problem. And if you're not exercising, you're not moving. Moving and exercise increases your blood flow. Blood flow has blood, which has oxygen, which heals your tissues. So there's that whole cascade there as well. Also, exercise increases endorphins. Endorphins are a fantastic way to shut down pain. So there's so many different things in that realm. Also, breathing. People in America do not know how to breathe. We're breathing, we're all alive, we're sitting up, but we're not breathing properly. You're supposed to breathe through your belly, not your chest. Women, we don't like to breathe through our belly because that makes us look fat. I mean, we've trained ourselves in that realm, and so most of us in America do not breathe properly. We don't breathe properly, we don't get oxygen, that same cascade. As well as mindfulness. What you think about, who you are, what your mindset is, creates your actions. If you're thinking about negativity all the time, and I'm in pain, this and that, that's what's gonna come, and negativity is gonna come. If you're thinking about positivity and things like that, that's what will come as well. Because what you think about breeds those actions. If you think about it, like they always say, fake it till you make it, put on a smile. If you start smiling, you're gonna start feeling happier because that it's your mindset. Because you have to think about smiling, so therefore you're creating a more positive mindset. Mindset creates end products as well. So again, not having a...
How do you direct your breathing to your belly instead of your chest? How do you do that?
Okay, we're gonna do a demo. Oh, we don't have enough time for all this. We're gonna have an hour of all talking then. Okay, so everyone, it's easier if you're laying on the ground, but we're not gonna all start laying on the ground right now. But I want you to put a hand on your belly, hand on your chest. Just breathe normally, just breathe, just think about it. Which hand is moving? You don't have to say out loud, you don't have to say this and that, but a lot of people, this hand, you want this hand to be the one that's moving much more. You want your belly to move first. And when you're breathing, your belly wants to come out first, then your ribs, then your chest. Chest goes down, ribs go down, belly goes down. It should be a progression of how it works. And when you land your back, it almost forces you to breathe properly. And so that's why I would suggest just go on your back, put your hands on your chest, and just realize what you're doing. Because if you're breathing from your chest, you're not getting enough oxygen. And you're actually almost reversing and having more carbon dioxide, which is gonna be a huge problem in your body. So breathing is a big, big, big thing. But I'll have a Facebook Live coming out and I'll talk about some of those things. Or if you want to talk about that in the future, ones of these, we can talk about that as well. But unfortunately, not enough time to dive into it. The last thing we're going to do before we go into more specific things, like perhaps another doctor's office, things like that.
Sorry, but may I ask one more question about that? If you find that your chest is going out more so than your belly, do you force your belly to go out even?
A lot of it's retraining of your brain, because you've trained your brain that that's what you're supposed to breathe. And so if you just start laying on your back and you just think about it, then that's gonna allow that process to happen more efficiently. And so it's a lot of it's just thought process. Other little nugget I'm gonna give, because this is beautiful, is if you're not breathing properly, that creates a lot of low back pain. Why? Because your diaphragm, which is right here, so you control with a lot of your breathing, it comes down and up with your breathing, is connected to your lumbar spine. So if you're not stabilizing properly, you're not breathing properly, you have an unstable lumbar spine, oftentimes. So, fun little tidbit of information there. Last thing we're gonna do, can I have a lovely volunteer for this? Well, not that one yet, but that's it. Can I have a volunteer? Well, all I'm gonna have you do is sit and stand on the ground. That's all we're gonna do. Wanna be a volunteer? Come on up. So this is something that's been in the news a lot lately as well. So let's come this way, make sure we're in the camera range. I don't even know if I was in the camera range for all of this, because I move around so much. Is that it's a good show of what they call all-cause mortality. Big words, I know. But it means that you're more likely to die from anything type thing. And so overall, it's a good marker of how healthy are you. Is your ability to sit on the ground and come back up without using your hands. Okay.
So this is what I get to try? Okay, so sit on the ground.
Yep. Without using your hands.
Oh, without, sit
okay.
without, okay.
Sit. That's fine. And come on back up without using your hands.
Okay.
Good. Okay, so then you can score that on a score of 10. 5 on the way down, 5 on the way up. You get 1 point taken
sorry,
off for every
up.
Time that you touch your hand, knee, elbow, this, and half point off for any time you lose your balance. And so, you probably lost one on the way down because you're
hanging
down.
Totally.
And then there was a little bit of balance losing on the way up, so
mm-hmm.
0.5
knees,
off.
Yeah.
Things like that. So, how they typically would do it, I'll take, you have to you have your shoes off. And so, oftentimes what they'll do, you're across your feet, come on down, and come on back up.
Just yeah, but none of us are young as you. I mean, come on. We
nope.
all can do that at your age.
Nope, and I'm just saying as something, and all that I'm using that as, but they've used in research, and they've seen that your ability to sit down and stand up without using your hands is a good measure of how healthy are you in general. And they found that from study after study after study that people that can't do that or have lower numbers have more heart disease, strokes, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, name it. Just because it's a show of just overall how healthy are you type thing is how what they're using it as. And so even now, you can do this today. You can go home, you don't have to do it here. You can kind of have someone take
see
a score
how it works,
of you,
yeah.
Before take a score of you and then start implementing some of these things and go home and then in a couple weeks, try it again. And by
see
where
how
I
much closer
be,
or how much, yeah, like is how much extra you need because even if you don't get it perfectly, you can lower how much effort it takes.
Exactly, 100%. And so you can use it as just a measure of just how am I doing? Am I getting better? And if after a long period of time you're still not getting where you need to go, maybe at that point it would be a good time to find another medical practitioner, someone to help you to reach those goals in perhaps a more definitive manner. So instead of trying a bunch of things, have them help you find a certain thing and target that along your way. Cool. Thank you
that's
very fun. Much, my volunteer. Okay. So any questions of that so far? Yes.
I have a question about the
curcumin?
No, up number 2 up there.
Casey.
Yes. I just yesterday was in Cleveland, Texas, where they have a raw milk farm, Linda's Raw
mm-hmm.
Milk. So for the first time, I brought back some raw milk and tried it, and it's fabulous.
Yep.
My doctor that I started with, a new doctor that I started with a month and a half ago, told me not to be on milk, to instead be on almond milk. So I have been for a month and a half. I don't like it. I want regular milk. So I bought a half gallon of this raw milk, hoping that it will be somehow as good for me as the almond milk. What's your opinion?
My opinion is for you to see how your body's responding to it. Because some people can tolerate dairy with no problem. Biggest thing you need to do, though, is take it out for 30 days. Because
take it out what?
Take it out 100% elimination diet for like 30 days. Because that's the only way you can tell how your body's really responding to it. If you take it out for completely 30 days and then you bring it back in and you notice you have a response, take it back out again for like 3 more days and then bring it back. Do you have a response? That will show you, is that an issue for you or not? Now, even if it's not, or even if you don't see a definitive thing, it could be because your body's reacting to other things that you're still already eating. And so that may not be the best way. And so a lot of these, for elimination style diet to really, really work, you need to cut out all the inflammatory foods, so like all of those things. For 30 days, and then bring your favorite one back in, like what you missed the most, bring that back in, for, and then only that for like 5 days. See, how did I respond to that? Oh, I did okay, fantastic. Maybe that's not an issue for me. Bring in the next thing, and I don't mean all dairy or all gluten. I mean like I missed cheese. I'm gonna bring back in cheese. I don't mean I'm gonna have cheese and milk and cream and ranch all in one day. Because then you don't know which part of that caused the issue for you, if you have a reaction. So that would be the style to come back with to determine what actually affected you or not. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. Any other questions? Perfect, okay. Last whole thing we're gonna do is I'm gonna use the volunteer. And, well, first off, does anyone have any chronic neck pain that they've had for a long, long period of time? Perfect. Come on up. Even if you don't want to, and that's the big thing, is whoever wants to do this. If you don't want to, I don't want to pressure you into this either. It's up to you.
That's my favorite thing to do.
What's up? No, it's up to you. If you're not comfortable with it, I will find something.
scoliosis, okay. And I know I had degenerative disc disease.
Okay.
In my head.
Okay.
And it's been years.
Okay. And so just kind of gradually keep on over time.
Yes.
Any certain motions, anything like that, seem to really aggravate it per se?
No.
So now have you do is face, yep, actually just like this. And go ahead and shoulders nice and back with that. Bring your chin all the way down to your chest. That's your time. Okay. So, not quite all the way down to her chest, but she has a little bit of degrees left. She's about to here. Okay? And so go ahead and look all the way to here for me. Best you can. Okay, so ideally, in full range of motion, you would want this, pull the ear, the shoulder, and the eye all be aligned. So like that would be ideal range of motion for your mask. And so running come right up here, face here. And then go ahead and bring your ear to your shoulder for me. And then other side, ear to other side.
Slowly.
Okay, very good. Come on back up. Perfect. Pain or discomfort with those motions?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And where did you feel the pain at?
My neck. Right here.
All the way through? Just right in the middle. Okay. And so she felt it right here in the middle. And so then go ahead and look all the way to the left for me. Okay. And so she's right here. And so ideally it would be 90 degrees up here, so she's about 45. Go ahead and look to the other side for me. And that's a little bit further. She's about at 60 there. Okay, go ahead and relax. Okay, so that's something that we would do in the office, just to see overall, how are we moving? How are all of our joints working together? Because what is this looking at? It's not only looking at how far can you go, it's also all of these nerves in your neck here feed these muscles here, as well as the muscles down your arms. And so that's looking at how are your muscles working? How are your joints working? How are your nerves working? How's everything in together working? And it could be coming from there, could be looking at how's the brain. So we're using this as a neurological screen to see, is there something that's going on that we might be able to help? And so that's just one aspect of what we would do. And then we would also next do what we call a myotome exam. Myotome meaning, myo meaning muscle. So we're using the muscles to look at how their nerves are working. And so this is a gold standard that most medical practitioners should do. All orthopedists, neurologists, MDs, everyone learns it because it's a gold standard of looking at how are the nerves working together. Okay, so it's a way of muscle testing and seeing how are the nerves that feed this muscle talking with the brain. So we're gonna just do that really quick. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna have you put your body in positions and just resist my pressure, okay? So go ahead and put your hands out just like this. I'm gonna try to push your fingers together. Don't let me move you. So spread nice and wide. Perfect. Okay, don't let me move you. Stronger is that?
I guess
she's not going anywhere. We're going to take your hand off.
That's weird.
Wow.
And go ahead and put your hand back there again. That's wrong again. Take your hand off.
This is magic, right?
So it's neurology. It's neurology. How are we doing that? This nerve comes out of our spine right here, comes all the way down, and hits right here in our triceps. Okay? So now what happens is if this nerve is not able to communicate effectively, that muscle may not be able to engage appropriately. So if we stimulate that nerve, we say, brain, pay attention to this, then it works more efficiently. So if you have an injury, you have a burn, what do? You rub it. Because you're bringing awareness from the brain to that position and not, and you're negating that pain signal. So when you're just stimulating that point, you're stimulating that nerve, strengthening that muscle. So what we would do in the office is that we would actually do a manipulation. I would do a chiropractic adjustment there, or you use acupuncture. You could use different ways to stimulate that nervous system to re-engage there appropriately. Interesting, huh?
Very.
So we're going to come back to this side. We're going to check the same muscles on this side because she's not just one side. We're going to check both. Okay, when was this our pressure again? Get her stopper.
No.
Okay, both here again. And right here. That one's nice and strong. This one is stronger again because you're stimulating it, but that one was weak before. Interesting. So it doesn't have to be on both sides of the body because your nerves out of your spine over here, and one goes down the right, one goes down the left. So just because you have pain here and weakness here does not mean it's going to happen on the other side. And so when you have problems with that nerve, that could be that you have pain in your shoulder, pain in your elbow, pain in your arm in general, pain in your scapula, because that muscle, your triceps, goes from your shoulder down into your elbow. So you can have pain in any one of those locations, or all of them, or you can even have it in your neck or in your wrist because you're compensating for this muscle not working. And you could have all of them because it's been happening for a long period of time. So that's something that you need to look at, is how are our muscles working together and how is our nervous system functioning? Cool. So we're gonna go right here. So now we're gonna check the biceps. Biceps, bi meaning two, two heads of that muscle. So we're gonna check here and here on both sides. There's resistance and pressure. Good, no problem?
No.
Right here, same thing. Awesome, no problems. Very, very, very complex. But that nerve, stimulating that nerve right there made that muscle go strong. Let's see if it helps your range of motion.
Cool.
Whatever you say.
Yes. So we're gonna have you touch. So, right there.
With my left hand.
With your, it doesn't really matter at this point. Okay. So right there. And so we're gonna turn this way. So go ahead and bring your chin to your chest as best you can. I know you have your hand there now. How much better is that? Let me come back over here so I can see. There's a little bit more range of motion there. And go ahead and look up at the ceiling for me. Look how much better that one was. She was there last time. And now she's there. Now it's not a huge, huge change, but that's just one thing. She's just poking one part out of her neck, and she's getting increased range of motion. Now, how was that for pain? Was there as much pain stimulating that point?
It was about the same.
About the same? And that's okay. That's okay.
It wasn't more.
I definitely want the honest thing. Don't tell me, it feels great, but it doesn't. So you come around here. Perfect. And so go ahead and touch right there again. And then go ahead and bring her ear to her shoulder.
It's a little different spot than you have.
Sympathetic over here is where you rest, digest, heal, all of those things. If you're in here all the time, you can't do all of these things. And so that's a huge part of it, is if you're just massively stressed, you won't be able to digest anything that you're putting in your body because you're so stressed. So that's the huge thing with health and wellness in general, is there's so many components, which makes it amazing, but makes it super frustrating and confusing at the same time. So all of it. But so what do we do today? We did a lot of different things. We talked about what is pain, just very in general, how it can come from trauma, non-trauma, chronic injuries, or chronic pain oftentimes goes into that non-traumatic metabolic type process. We talked about how can we fix it. So we can do some dietary changes. We can heal our gut, allow our body to actually get those nutrients where they need to go. We can change our diet with specific nutrients that really target inflammation and help that process along. We can also look at our sleep and exercise and stress and breathing. We can look at all those different things to see how are we doing to lay a foundation for our bodies for healing. What is our mindset? What is all these things that we can do to set that foundation that we can heal and we can alleviate that chronic pain, that we can live that pain-free lifestyle. We can increase function. We can increase quality of life. And then at the end, we just did, what would we do potentially where you tried all of these things and we're not getting better? What can we do at like someone's office when we go into someone to have a more professional assistance, things like that, by looking at the nervous system? So that's kind of what we ended up there. So that is what I have prepared today. If you guys have any questions for me, I know we kind of did them throughout as well, which was beautiful. Any last questions for me? Yes.
Can chiropractic help neuropathy? My mom has real bad problems with his feet and lower legs.
With a lot of neuropathy, things like that, from diabetic induced, it depends on how far gone it is, and or how far along.
She's not diabetic.
Okay. So things like that, it depends on what's causing the neuropathy and what can we do. By healing the body, decreasing inflammation, we can get more blood supply to those nerves and allow them to start that healing process. So potentially we could. It depends on what's causing it, and again, how far along. If there's a point where all of the blood vessels have died and we can't get blood back in there, and we don't have the ability to, because your blood vessels are also very smart. If you have like a block in your heart, your blood vessels will make a new route. That's what they do. They're ingenious. Your body is ingeniously designed by God. It's amazing. Amazing. But so there's so much you can do to naturally heal, but sometimes there gets to a point where you can't. And so I've seen a lot of amazing instances of things like that in our office and in different chiropractic offices. But with anything of this, I can't guarantee results because you don't know.
What about diabetic-induced neuropathy where you're all of a sudden you have terrible pain in your toe or whatever?
Same thing. I'm treating a diabetic veteran right now, and we've been able to get quite a bit of good results, things like that. But some of those things are so far gone or so far along that it's hard to get all of that back. And if you do, it's a huge, long process. It's a long process that got you there. It's going to be a long process that's going to get you back. It's not going to be like a 1 week, wow, I have sensation again. Like, it's going to be a really stepwise where you even notice it. But eventually, like, you'll be like 2 years later, a couple months later, or this later, and you're like, wow, I can do that. And I never was able to do that before. But it's nothing that you're really going to notice like that. Because a lot of these things, it's when you're healing the body naturally, it takes more time, and it's something that you won't notice except for, again, down the road, being like, wow, I can do that. I didn't realize I wasn't able to do that before. Whereas a lot of medications, when you shut down biological processes, sometimes it works faster, but then the bad part is that you're shutting down biological processes and a lot of other things happen as well. So it just depends. Does that answer your question?
Okay.
Yes.
Do you do chiropractic therapy for plantar fasciitis? Because I suffer from those all the time.
Yep.
And I've read online about different therapies that a chiropractor can do in your foot that can actually get pretty immediate
results. Yep, there's a lot of different things that my office, other chiropractic offices, things like that can do. Acupuncture has also had good results with my
fasciitis. Because I've already had the cortisone shot this time, and it hasn't helped.
Yep.
Good shoes are an amazing thing for that.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
It's taken care of mine totally.
Yes.
Good shoes.
Good shoes is huge. And that's the big thing. And so a lot of times, unfortunately, they're not the cute shoes.
I know. But they're better than they used to be.
Yeah. Yeah, they're not always the cute shoes, but yes, these are better than some, but my shoes are not even the best shoes that people should be wearing either. Yeah, what you put on your feet and how you have that foundation has a huge impact on the rest of your body. Because if your feet are off, guess what? There goes your knees, there goes your hips. It just depends on where your body's weak link is, where your weak chain is, depending on what other past injuries you've had as to where you're going to feel the pain. Okay. Any last minute questions for me? Otherwise, if you guys would also like my business cards, I'll be right back with them. I had an armload of everything coming in, and unfortunately the business cards did not make the armload.
Yes, it did.
So I will do that, and if you guys have any last minute questions for me when I come back, I would love to answer them. And I have the whole rest of the morning. My next patient's at 2, so I have plenty of time.
Where is your office?
Jones in 1960.
Oh, I took notes.
Yep.
Oh,
so in Jersey Village area.
My notes.
So I will be right back.